This is Christopher with AG Productions. Welcome to Watch Me Work. This is the first episode of Watch Me Work on Sorsha, our really awesome-looking Kador Warcaster. This is one of my favorite miniatures from the Kador line. It's been a favorite since I saw it the very first time. I love this variant model of Sorsha. Very, very cool. Just really excited about painting this thing. I want to take you on a brief, and I do mean brief, walkthrough of the miniature prior to getting into painting the model. Probably not going to paint too much on the miniature today. But let's just jump right in and show you exactly what we're going to be doing, all right? As you can see, the base on the miniature, very sort of slate-style base. This is the exact same style base that I used in the Let's Paint Kador Manhunter DVD set. I wanted to kind of keep with the same theme. In my mind, the Kador are... you know, they're very harsh people, so I want a nice rugged piece of terrain. And aside from that, the slate gives a really good contrast to the rest of the miniature because slate has a nice bluish-gray texture to it, or bluish-gray tone to it, which is a nice cool color versus the warmth that the rest of the miniature is going to exude, with the possible exception of this pick weapon right here that may end up becoming like an ice weapon. Haven't really decided on that one yet, but most of the rest of the miniature is going to be a lot of kind of anywhere between deep to mid-tone reds with a lot of blacks and grays involved in. So a lot of really dark, kind of warm colors, and so to set the miniature off and sort of make it pop, we're going to utilize a slate base, which will end up being a nice cool color, give a really good contrast, and it's going to make those colors on the miniature really stand out and just make the miniature that much more vibrant, that much brighter, and stand out that much more on the tabletop. So we're going to kind of, like I said, just sort of giving you an idea of what I'm going to be planning on doing. Let's take a look at the shoes of the miniature. This is an area that I particularly like. You can see, perhaps, if I hold the miniature steady enough, the shoes of the miniature are high heel shoes. Now, they did not come as you see them there. This piece right here, this sort of triangular bit that you can see through on each of the shoes, that was a solid piece when I originally got this miniature. I actually had to cut those little triangles out. Now, to do that, what I utilized was my pen vise. Essentially, I've done this before on several miniatures, and it took me a while to figure out how to do it properly without wrecking the model. The first time I did it, I ended up cutting the feet off the miniature. The second time I did it, I ended up knocking the heels off of the miniature, and I just couldn't figure out how to get it done. But finally, over time, I developed a really nice technique, and basically all you do is you cut the tab off the base of the miniature like you would normally do if you're going to be designing your own base. And what I did was I come in and I drill at the apex of the triangle. All right, so in this case, right up here where the heel meets the top of the shoe, or the midpoint of the shoe. All right, and I just drill all the way through that. And then I drill a couple of smaller holes towards the bottom, where the lower portion of the heel connects to the sole of the shoe, all right? And then what I do is gently, and I do mean very gently, take my hobby knife and just sort of press between the two holes, and the pressure of the knife, assuming you've got a nice sharp knife, will just barely slide through those what is remaining of the material between the heel and the actual shoe itself, or the heel and the sole of the shoe. And then you can just kind of clean it up with your hobby knife or with a nice round file. Excuse me. It's rather late in the evening. I apologize for that. But you can clean it up with your hobby knife or a nice round file and just make that area nice and neat. And it makes the miniature look much, much better. I'm telling you, if you'll just take the 10 minutes that it takes to knock out those little grooves between the heel and the sole of the boot, it makes a monumental difference in the miniature. It's kind of like drilling out the gun barrels of a Space Marine's bolter. It seems such a small step, and it truly is. And you kind of think to yourself, you know, why do it? But in the end, it really, really adds something to the miniature. Now, let's take a look at this boot over here. As you can see, hopefully at least, this boot is not quite touching the ground. I can actually slip my hobby knife underneath it. All right, on the heel back here. Now, I had initially planned to bulk up the slate base to compensate for that, because this is actually a sculpting defect. The two sides of the heels don't line up correctly. It's just part of the model. But I got to thinking, and I got to looking at the miniature. Let's take a look at the model. All right. So, over here on the miniature's right leg. Well, let's take a look at the left leg here. The left leg, nice and straight. Heel touches the ground. Sole of the boot touches the ground. Pretty reasonable. However, let's take a look at the right leg. The right leg over here is, number one, angled way out to the side. All right. I mean, logically speaking, if we were standing here in this position, we'd basically be leaning over sideways. This is not a normal position in which one would stand. Okay. Additionally, the knee is bent and it's cocked inward. All right. So, taking into account human anatomy, if the knee bends and the toe of the foot stays on the ground, what happens? The heel comes off the ground. So, ideally, what's happening here is she's in the middle of a step. That's what I'm thinking is what's going on. She's probably about to step inwards with this foot, but because that knee is bent slightly and cocked inward just a little bit, and because the foot itself is cocked inward just a little bit, that indicates to me that the heel doesn't need to touch the ground. And once I figured that out, I said, you know what? There's no point in bulking the back of this thing up. I'm just going to leave it like it is, because according to human anatomy, that's exactly what should be happening. So, really, really quick lesson in sort of watching your miniature, kind of getting an idea of exactly what's going on and whether or not you really do need to take the time to fix things, because sometimes you really don't, because what's going on with the miniature causes certain things to happen on the model, like in this case with the heel coming off the ground. It's something that's not really necessary for me to go in and fix. All right, so let's talk about the hands very quickly. The hands, I admit, were a pain in the backside. Now, the reason they were a pain in the backside is the joins here on the wrist are incredibly tiny, which means they have to be pinned, all right? Otherwise, again, I apologize for yawning, my goodness. Whew. At some point, I'm going to do some of these videos during the daytime when I have a day off. But the pins, or the joints here, are very, very small, which means if somebody hits this weapon right here, the wrists are probably going to be or become detached, and so they had to be pinned in place. Well, in order to do that, you have to have two pins going at two completely different angles. You have to have one pin going this way and one pin going sort of out and kind of towards the camera. All right, so let's think about this for a second. All right, let me zoom out so you can kind of get an idea here of what I'm dealing with, or what I dealt with in the preparation of the miniature. What is that that's on this? Oh, okay, that's a piece of paper up there. I was looking in this corner up here trying to figure out what that piece of paper was. All right, so actually, let's take this here. Okay, so basically you've got two pins sort of like this in the miniature. All right, so let's say that there's two holes here, one underneath each one of the pins, and you've got to put these pins into those two holes. Well, logic says pretty easy, except for the fact that when you press down, you're also pressing outwards. So that join was really, really, really difficult to pin. It took a lot of pressure to get both of the pins into the arm sockets, because at the same time I'm pressing them downwards, I'm also having to press them outwards, and it just, not fun, but in the end, That join right there is incredibly strong, and I don't think it will ever come apart. Now, in addition to that, on top of having to pin the wrists, at the exact same time I had to pin the wrists, I had to pin the staff together here. Now, you can see just a little teeny tiny crack right there. I'll fix that with paint when we actually get into painting the staff here that this weapon is on. But essentially, other than having the wrist to pin, we now have a third pin that has to happen all at the same time. So it was a very, very complex process to put this together in a manner that I know it's not going to come apart. Beyond that, pretty simplistic miniature. I mean, really great looking model, very few mold lines, really just a classic sculpt by one of my favorite sculptors. Hopefully you can see that down there at the bottom. That's Van Klok, if I remember correctly. You can tell basically by the face here. That is a Van Klok face. Now, I say that, but it might have been sculpted by somebody else, but that face is very reminiscent of his face, and I believe, if I'm not mistaken, that that actually is his signature down there. So anyway, really, really great sculpt. Looking forward to getting into it, and let's get started right now, shall we? The first thing I want to do is base coat the base, and that may end up being all that we do in this episode, because this is probably going to take a few minutes. I've got my base color mixed up here, literally the base color, and I'm just going to grab some of my mixing brush, because there's no sense in using a fancy brush for this, especially when you've got a nice sculpted base like this. You really don't want to use your good brushes for something like this, because, to be perfectly honest with you, a base like this with a lot of cuts and cracks and crevices and things like that, that can wreck a good brush really, really quickly. So I'm just using my junky mixing brush here for this, and we're going to see exactly how it turns out. All right, I'm excited to finally be getting some paint on this miniature. This is going to be one of my favorites. I can see it already. Now, I say that now, probably by episode 10, I'll be cursing this thing six ways to Sunday. But for right now, I am really excited about this model. This is one I've been wanting to paint for a very long time, and just never did get around to it. Quite happy about this. Now, we've got some areas on the base that are a little bit dodgy. They're not sculpted as well as I would like them to be. They're not, some of the cracks are not filled in as much as I would like them to be. But I'm not concerned, because those areas we're probably going to fill in with a little bit of snow. And I think that will cover up any areas of concern, and I think we'll be all right. But we shall see what happens. You know, it would be really nice if one of these videos, I actually spent the entire video in frame. Wouldn't that be cool? Now, it would help if I spun the camera slightly to the right, and that way it's like over here, more in the area of where I normally hold my models. But sometimes I just like to go all over the place. Sort of like this. There you go. How's that for 1080p? Hopefully your computer is holding on. There you go. Alright. Now. Well, thank you, Avast. I appreciate you updating my virus database. I love when my computer talks to me. That's so nice of it. Alright. We're just sort of poking into the model here. Perky, perky, perky. All right. Yep. There we go. This might actually end up being a two-part episode. Christopher bases or paints the base of a miniature. I guarantee if we go into two parts, the second part will be painting something else on the model while we wait for the base to dry. But we'll see what happens. I can pretty much guarantee we're going to have a second coat But next time when we come back, I'm not going to talk so much because we've already got our preliminary stuff out of the way. And, yeah, hopefully it'll go a little faster. But I think that'll just about do it for right now. Keep poking in there a little bit. And just because the white's kind of ticking me off, I'm going to go ahead and ring the base. There we go. Now that's not going to end up being blue in the end, or grayish blue. It's going to end up being black, but I just want to get rid of that white for right now. And since the I had already gotten a little bit of this color on it, and that color hadn't dried yet, I'm just going to utilize it to paint around the entire base and just sort of get rid of that white. That white, I like to use a white primer because it kind of it helps me to see the areas that I haven't painted yet, the areas that I've kind of missed. It doesn't really change the intensity of the color like a lot of people think it does, and I need to do a video on that. I've been meaning to for years. Truthfully, depending on your style of painting, my style of painting, I can do it. If you paint to a something above a tabletop level, there's really no difference at all between black and white primer. I know there's this big debate about, you know, black primer is great for darker models and white primer is great for light models and all this kind of stuff, but it's a bunch of crap. You can paint any kind of model with any kind of primer you want to. The only difference in primers is, you know, how much you want to pay and the tooth or the grain of the primer that you're dealing with. But for me, I like to use a white because it helps me to see what hasn't been painted. But there are instances where having that white can be very, very distracting, like down here on the base. If that's not painted in for me, it's very weird because as I'm painting the miniature, I keep seeing little flakes of white down here and thinking that I've missed something that I should have painted previously. So anytime I've got an area like that, I like to go in and just go ahead and cover it with paint, even if it hasn't, the color that I'm covering it with is not going to be the final color. I just like to kind of get it out of the way, and that way it's not distracting while I paint the rest of the miniature. But I think we're going to call it there for right now, and I think around about 18 minutes or so. And yeah, we'll pick it up next time. Probably come in, put in another layer of paint here, and then move somewhere else on the miniature. My guess, throwing this out there, I don't know, is probably up to the head to do a little work on the head while the base dries. And then when the base is dry, we'll come back in and we'll highlight the base and just move on from there. But for right now, we're going to call it done. So I hope that you have enjoyed this very first episode of Watch Me Work on Sorsha. Hope you're as excited about this miniature as I am. And if you happen to have any comments or questions, feel free to drop those in the comment section down below. Also, be sure to leave a thumbs up on this video and subscribe to AG Productions if you haven't done so already. Again, I want to thank you very, very much for watching. God bless you all. Have an outstanding rest of the day, and I will see you all in the next video.